digest.
We can wait another few minutes. Let's see, thank you for coming. Maybe we'll hear from Ben and Jay. Are you guys here?
Yeah, we are.
Did you want to address the crowd before we call to order?
We should have time to do the interview. We are here to remind you our names.
Yes, please introduce yourself.
So thank you guys for letting us come and address you for a couple minutes. We'll be short. I know there's a lot of stuff to cover. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Ben Jicklin. This is Jay Hooper. We represent five towns: Brookfield, Braintree, Randolph, Roxbury, and Granville. We actually both live in Granville. So what we're going to do... So we're going to give a brief update on what we've been working on in our committees and what's been going on in the legislature, hoping to answer just a couple questions and then let you get on to more interesting stuff.
So I serve on the House Ag and Forestry Committee, and in Ag, we've been discussing like five or eight different issues, and I'll just give you a little bit about a few of them. Milk prices continue to decline for our dairy industry, so we're really glad that the Milk Commission was able to report to us recommendations as to what we ought to do for the 2018 Farm Bill, our federal delegation ought to do, so that's Welch, Sanders, and Leahy. Luckily, we also had Leahy secure $1.1 billion in insurance monies to help keep farmers who are really struggling to stay in business. We also looked at a bill which we passed through the House on a voice vote about on-farm accessory businesses so that farmers can explore alternative ways to come up with some revenue sources that will help them stay viable as a farming practice and operation. We passed a bill to require state fairs and carnivals to inspect their amusement rides. Believe it or not, Vermont is one of six states that doesn't require that legally. So we thought, even though we haven't had much for tragedy in that area, we ought to be proactive about it. And we hope that that will prevent tragedy in the future. We've been discussing pollinator protection legislation, so reevaluating ag practices in the context of invertebrates, so honeybees namely, but also other pollinators, like let's say the carpenter bee. Turns out a lot of those pollinator populations are declining pretty quickly. And of course, those insects are what make it so we can all have potlucks. We've also talked a lot about regenerative ag practices. It's been interesting to take testimony on that topic because it turns out there's discord in the organic farming community as to what it means to be to practice regenerative agriculture as well as organic. I think there's some battles to be fought there, and we'll figure that out in the coming years. But conventional dairy and organic and regenerative, there's kind of a rivalry there that's difficult in some circles. And of course, forestry operations. We don't talk about forestry as much in my committee as I would hope, but I think when we get back from town meeting week, I think we'll dive right into a right to forest bill that came over to us from the Senate. So hopefully we can put that on the governor's desk before we're all wrapped up.
So I serve on the House Healthcare Committee, and the way that it works in the legislature is for most of the first part of the session, we're in committee 80 to 90% of the time, so I've been deep into a lot of the weeds of healthcare policy. A couple things we've been focusing on. One, we passed a series of measures in response to executive actions from the federal government. A lot of these measures that we've been passing are, intended to protect a lot of the market stability and make sure that we can curb the growth of insurance premiums. Secondly, we've continued to respond to the mental health crisis that's been going on in our state. Last year, we put a pretty significant investment into a lot of our community providers, our designated agencies. This year, we're considering further investment into those areas, as well as considering an expansion into our, you know, acute inpatient services. We've seen a real backlog in a lot of our emergency rooms, and we need to do a better job of making sure there's flow throughout the system. Finally, we've considered the potential of Vermont imposing a state health insurance mandate. You may remember the Trump administration in the fall repealed that piece of the ACA, basically zeroed out that penalty. And there are concerns. We've heard a number of from a number of actuaries around the potential for insurance premiums to go up 2 to 3% just because of a lack of a mandate. And if we're asking for insurance companies to cover a wider benefit of things such as pre-existing conditions, we need a broad and healthy insurance market. So those are a couple things that we're working on. We're happy to take questions about anything that you've heard about what's going on in Montpelier.
Do you know anything about this proposed legislation to allow us to import drugs from Canada?
Yeah, so the Senate passed out a bill last week that would allow Vermont to basically act as a wholesaler and import prescription drugs from Canada. It's a great proposal, except we need approval from the federal government to do it. So chances of it happening in practice are very slim, but it will be in our committee after town meeting.
Yeah, the drug companies just raised their prices 10% in January.
Yeah,
no. Across the board.
Yep. Hi, Carlos. When I met with you when you had your legislative breakfast in Hancock, I had mentioned the difficulty that some of these smaller towns have in finding qualified people to perform the functions, and that in the past it always taken a charter change in order to have people serve. So you know all of this. Any progress on that side, or is it you've been?
You mean your request to have a certain position for the roads? Was that what?
Well, it was an example of that.
Yep.
I'll start from the beginning. A long time ago, if you wanted to get rid of your auditors, you had to have a charter change. Then the legislature said, no, you can just vote on it. Then there was a thing of having listers. You had to have a charter change, and the legislature said, no, you can just do that. It was 10 years ago, maybe, Norm, one of our selectmen at the time, trying to get a charter change in order to allow our town treasurer's town clerk to be a non-resident. And obviously, you know, grief involved there. But that's an ongoing thing, particularly in small communities where we just don't have the resources.
So after we talked a couple weeks ago, I think it was, I did talk with a couple of my colleagues in the House Government Operations Committee where a lot of this work would be done. My relaying of your information, that was not the first time they've heard it, and they've heard from a number of small towns around the state, that there needs to be a reconsideration about the flexibility to make those type of changes as demographics shift. So it's something that I know that at least a couple members that I spoke with are interested in, and you know, once they begin working on a lot of the Senate bills, there may be an appropriate time to have that discussion.
Thank you.
Yep. Any other questions?
Thank you very much.
Thank you, guys.
So we prepared for you some town meeting reports, and then in the back there, if you'd like to see a little more.
Thank you.
Just a little housekeeping news and procedures. The water here is failing, so we want to conserve as much water as we can. If for some reason the meeting is in jeopardy, we'll talk about that later, but we could postpone to another time and place that's definite, but I don't think we'll have to do that, but if anybody's concerned about that. Secondly, when you all go to vote paper ballot, make sure you state your name twice, going in to Nancy and coming out to Kate. because don't assume she knows your name, and even if she does know your name, she'll forget it.
I beg you, stand in front of us.
Yeah.
I know.
Let's see.
So, Mark, yeah, just on behalf of the Grange, thank you for your donations for the dinner, and thank you for folks that brought in stuff. We appreciate that very much. Also, we have a dinner St. Patrick's Day at the Grange Hall, our usual time, so Thanksgiving dinner. So, be prepared for it, I guess.
I was late, so there's more shepherd's pie.
Yeah, there's plenty of food in there, so don't be bashful.
Is it good for your teeth?
Yes.
Okay. Okay,
so we'll call the meeting to order. I think, did we already do that officially? Just some procedural reminders. We govern this body by Robert's Rules of Order. The first item on that list is when you want to speak, please raise your hand. And I will call on you. You'll speak. Unless there's an objection, I'd like to keep the discussion to 5 minutes. Robert's Rules says 10. But there's a lot of people, and everybody gets a chance to speak twice in the scenario. After I call on everybody, can speak again. So if there's no objection, I'd like to keep it to 5 minutes. Great.
Per person?
Per person, yes. So, great, there's no objection. An article has to be moved by somebody on the floor, seconded, and I have to read it before we discuss it. So that's the procedure for that. After you've spoken once, you'll have to be seated, and then after everyone else has had a chance to speak, if you want to talk again, I will call on you again. I'll make an attempt to call on everybody in the order I see your hands go up. I noticed some people here who may not be registered voters. Is that, if that's true, raise your hand if you're not registered to vote.
In Granville.
In Granville, right. So Robert's Rules also doesn't really allow you to speak, but again, unless there's an objection, I would very like to entertain people who aren't registered here but own property here or come here to have a say. So, unless there's an objection, you guys can talk. You can get them. 5 minutes. Oh, no, actually, 2.5 minutes. After we're discussing an article, debate ends by someone calling the question. So don't just yell out, I'm going to call the question. Raise your hand to be recognized, and then we'll call the question that way. If you just yell out, call the question, and I don't recognize you, we can still discuss whatever it is. So, do you have a question?
Yeah, I do. Given that, is there a certain sort of mannerism to that where you wouldn't just call the question to squash what people want to?
No, well, yeah, there's a procedure. So,
okay.
You know.
So you can choose not to raise it.
Yeah. But if Jim calls the question, if he raises his hand and I call on Jim and he says, I call the question, somebody seconds it, and we all vote on it.
Right, but what if the discussion isn't finished?
Well, somebody will object.
Okay.
It has to be voted on by at least 2/3 of the membership. It's not even a majority to call the question, right? So, you know, I mean, we're talking about
everybody says yay.
What's that?
I said if everybody says yay and call the question, it's over.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
And yeah, that's about it. So. I'd entertain a motion for bringing Article 1 to the floor.
Second.
Okay, Article 1, to elect a moderator for the year ensuing.
Nominate Roger Sanders. I second.
Any other?
I move the nomination be closed and that the secretary cast one ballot in favor of Roger.
I second it.
Okay. All in favor of me being the moderator, say aye.
Here's the part, does that part, but
we'd like to move part of
the
oh. And a paper ballot needs to be cast for voting for selectmen. All the other elections can be done either by voice voter and select persons. What did I say?
Who's the selectman?
I move we move to Article 2.
That's good. Just move Article 2. Judy's moving Article 2, so it needs to be seconded. To elect all town officers as required by law. A, to elect a select person for a three-year term ending 2021. So I'd entertain some nominations. Norm.
I nominate Sean Lenski.
Second.
Yep. Dennis.
I nominate Jim Day.
Second. So this is Sean's position?
Yes. Yes. Oh, yeah. Sean's term is ending now. So we have. Two nominations, Sean and Jim. Is there anyone else who would like to nominate someone?
I move the nomination cease.
Second.
All in favor of closing nominations, say aye.
Aye.
Nominations are closed.
Candidates want to say anything?
That's a good idea. Would you guys like to say something?
Yeah, I would. 5 years ago, if you ever asked me if I ever want to be a selectman, I would have said no. And, getting into politics and working for the town, I've really enjoyed it. And made some good friends here, and we're working real good together. I've been working on the ancient trails that I'm really enjoying. Working on getting the post office set up. And I'd like everyone's voted. Glad. Thank you.
What do we say? Well, I would like to try to aid the town in kind of gaining on their unity and make it affordable for folks to pay their taxes. I have 20 plus years of experience in financial management, 10 plus years in management of road systems. And since I just newly retired, I have extra time and thought that I would, you know, like to contribute to the well-being of y'all, and that's what I'm going to do. Thank you.
Time to vote. We'll vote by paper ballot. If everybody's agreeable to that. Thank you.
universe in the name for a long time.
I love those mountains.
Sean Linsky, 19. Jim Daigle is the select person for the next 3 years. Sean will be at every meeting.
No, I won't.
B, to elect a delinquent tax collector for a 1 year term ending 2019.
Nancy Needham, second.
Any other nominations?
Can I move that we do this by a show of hands?
Correct. If there's no other nominations for delinquent tax collector, motion to close nominations?
Move to close nominations.
Okay.
Second.
All in favor of Nancy Needham, say aye.
Aye. Which one is a show of hands?
Huh? Oh.
The one is a second.
You want to show of hands?
Aye.
A show of hands? Aye is good too. Anybody opposed to Nancy Needham? Raise your hand. Nancy Needham's the tax collector.
For delinquent, can you write that down?
C, to elect a town grand juror for a 1 year term ending 2019. I'm not sure who it is.
Who is it?
It might be Diane.
It's Mike Garamo.
It's Mike Garamo.
Are you the grand juror?
I'm sorry, what was the same thing?
Or say aye.
Aye.
Mike, you're in your town, whatever.
This is a
to elect an agent to prosecute and defend suits for a 1 year term ending 2019.
We need that.
I have a question.
Yes.
Could someone explain what that person's responsibility actually is?
Yeah, I don't think they have one. That's
and
a good question.
Who is it now?
It's Diane.
It's Diane Arrow at the moment. But I'm just wondering, I mean, I know that we've been embroiled in a lawsuit. Is there anything, I mean, what does that position actually do? Does it do anything?
What is a grand jury?
I don't know.
Nothing.
I do. I know what a grand jury is.
What? Yeah, Jim would like to explain the grand jury.
Basically, it's like being on jury duty, but it's on a federal level. And I remember Alan Christie had to do it.
Oh.
And she had to drive to Rutland. It's quite a chore. Get ready.
Yeah, she was on it for like a year. Federal cases in Rutland.
So what's the agent to prosecute and defend suits? The wording is an agent to prosecute and defend suits for a 1 year term ending 2019.
Oh. So
I personally don't know what that is. The leftover.
Who's doing that now?
Diane Arrow.
Is she here?
No. She's not here. So we can nominate her.
Sure. I'll nominate her.
There's a nomination today.
I'll second it.
There's a second. Any other nominations?
Move nominations be closed.
Second.
Nominations are closed. All in favor of
Diane
Arrow to be agent to prosecute and defend suits for a 1 year term ending in 2019, say aye. Were you going to raise your hand?
I'll wait till the slope.
Okay. Say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay.
Okay, just a point of order so we understand. But it seems that when a motion is made and seconded, it has to be voted on before you move on to something else.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, we said let's close nominations on the second,
yep.
And you took that as.
Yeah, you're right. We'll do that. Thank you.
Yeah.
E. To elect the cemetery commissioner for a 3 year term ending 2021.
So whose term is this?
That's my turn.
Nominate Mark Pullough.
Who seconded? Ken seconded.
Mark, do you want to do this again?
Yeah.
Then I move the nominations to cease.
Nancy second. All in favor of ceasing nominations? Say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
That was Judy's second.
Yes.
Yeah. All in favor, who did we get? Oh, Mark. All in favor of Mark Belial to be the cemetery commissioner, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Mark is that. To elect another cemetery commissioner to complete a term ending in 2020, I believe it was...
That would be me.
Who?
She was appointed.
That would be me.
Oh, you, okay.
That's a good question.
It's Mary's...
Mary is appointed, that's all. Mary can't do it anymore.
So you're not, so if you're nominated for...
It's really open.
It's really open, right, so... Any other ideas for cemetery commissioners?
It's a great job.
Would you have a cemetery commissioner explain what it is that they're responsible for?
Sure. Margaret, or...
Cheryl?
I want Cheryl, I mean, Margaret, Cheryl, you want to...
Well, a cemetery commissioner oversees the cemeteries. We sell plots so that you can have a resting place for your loved one. And, you know, we have a lot of work that needs to be done in the cemetery, so we need people that are willing to work and help us get things in shape.
Do you do like a grant day versus our cemetery?
Well, we don't.
Yeah, we could do that.
We've done that in the past too, and the cemetery commissioners themselves have done stuff, but my understanding though is also this year the current people we have contract for mowing services, part of their contract is cleanup. So, probably, we do have to replace the flagpole this year and some other things, but we have work to go do this year, so.
Yeah, we have three cemeteries to keep track of.
Nobody's digging to be the cemetery commissioner?
Nor Arsenal, are you interested in this?
There's not a lot of work involved with it. I shouldn't say that, there's some work involved, but I mean, it's...
Can the commissioners appoint someone?
We can, that's what we had to do for a vacant position, but ideally it's an elected position. There should be someone like that.
Who's not here that we can... Vivian's here.
John.
Marilyn?
Marilyn?
I do it, but I don't believe anyone will vote for me. I'll nominate Marilyn. I'm obviously very interested in the subject.
I think we need a conference.
Oh, wait a minute.
Well, I can stay out of that stuff.
Right, that might not be an area until you resolve the...
Yeah, I just meant I could stay out of anything like that and just do the other stuff.
Yeah, maybe a conference thing, which is...
Well, Diane isn't here.
Diane. There are a lot of young people in town who might be interested in doing something for the town. This is a good way to get into town politics, young people.
Yes.
We'll need a new grave digger, too.
Well, you don't have to do that.
That's a paid position, though.
Melissa or John or... I actually think we've got young people who might be interested.
Maybe Mark or
quarterly, maybe?
Sure.
Yeah, we don't meet that often.
Yeah, we don't meet that often.
We'll be meeting soon, obviously, after the town meeting, to go over the fine details and do our spring plan, per se. But other than that,
it's mostly field work.
Yes, Judy.
And also, in the commission's report, or somewhere, it makes it clear that a lot of work, the actual work, is often done by volunteers, not necessarily cemetery commissioners.
Yeah, we don't get paid, so it's all volunteers.
No, but I mean, oh, I thought it meant there were other volunteers.
Yes, we have some, we're gonna have to pay for some stuff this year.
I'm not sure I'm gonna nominate you, but I.
Can I?
True.
I nominate Kathy.
There's a nomination for Kathy.
Second Kathy.
Do I hear another one?
Thought nomination's closed.
I'm gonna second that.
Second.
All in favor of closing nominations, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Did she know it?
Yes.
All in favor of Kathy Warner as Cemetery Commissioner, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you.
Thank you.
See, if I was sure, she'd have to grab something, you know, get. It's getting on order. To elect a first constable for a 2-year term ending 2020.
I nominate Mark Belisle.
Second for Mark Belisle. Anyone else want to be constable?
I vote for Belisle.
Second on closing nominations?
Second.
All in favor of closing nominations, say aye.
Aye.
No one opposed? All in favor of Mark Belisle as the constable for the next year, say aye.
Aye.
2 years.
Oh, 2 years, sorry.
Aye.
Okay, that's going by fast. And anyone opposed?
No.
Okay. Yes, you.
Oh, never mind. Now we get to
yeah, we get to vote.
Okay.
Go on. H, to elect a second constable for a 1-year term ending 2019.
Is Brent Stickney doing a good job?
I guess he is.
Yeah.
He's a very nice guy.
Oh, that goes without saying. Is he good, doing a good job?
Yeah, he has a good rapport with all the.
I nominate Brent Stickney.
Second. Brent Stickney has been
our second
constable.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. Brent Stickney, and we have a second from did Judy second it?
Just for people's knowledge, if you're not aware, it's more of a contact person in East Granville, because he's from East Granville. He's not a certified constable, but he's just more of a the arms and eyes of the town.
I need a motion to cease nominations.
Well, one item I'd like to bring up first. Going back to item D.
That's out of order until actually.
I move nominations to cease the second constable.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I second.
I thought.
Okay. All in favor of closing nominations?
Aye.
Opposed? All in favor of Brent Stickney as the second constable, say aye.
Aye.
Anybody opposed? Oh, Brent said. As a point of order, he's not supposed to do this, but unless anybody objects, Dick has something to say about a previous article.
Yeah, every year I've been here, we've gone through that, and I've never really understood it. And Kay asked, well, what does it mean? I don't think I understood what I was told this time. Going forward, I'd like us to describe and define that item
D?
More completely. And if it's no consequence, remove it.
So just a note of thought, if I may.
Yeah.
Some of the other towns I go to have a description in the book to tell what the job does. That might be something.
Okay.
Oh, that's great.
Great.
There'll be another page in the book.
Okay. Did everybody understand Dick's concern is that we have descriptions of some of these jobs for next year, so we know what they are. Would someone like to move Article 3?
I move Article 3.
I'll second it.
Article 3, to hear the selectman's report and act upon the same.
Dick would like to say a few words first about EC Fiber, a very exciting opportunity coming to Granville this year.
Yeah, we didn't think it was going to happen maybe in 2020, but since they have decided that we are so underserved with high-speed internet, we're going to get it in 2018, as you've seen, and we're already stringing some of the wire on the poles and doing the make-ready work, and that's very, very exciting. Today, I've brought a little document that's called Connecting to the EC Fiber Network. It's a guide that tells you how you can do it if you have an underground conduit. Save a lot of money, you can do this yourself, and it describes, gives a complete specification for how to do it. they're on the back table. If anybody thinking of getting into this, they're there for you.
It's a very exciting opportunity because they're stringing every pole in Granville, which they don't normally do. They usually say you need 6 or 8 people per mile. And this year, every telephone pole will have fiber on it. So you can go to the nearest telephone pole. If it's just a string to your house, overhead, it's not going to cost very much at all.
I signed up for EC Fiber years ago. As a matter of fact, Vivian, remember we went to the meetings 4 or 5 years ago?
A long time.
And I signed up, and it was so hard to sign up online then. I signed up yesterday, now, it's a piece of cake. You go through it 5 seconds flat, and they get right back to you. So it's real easy to do.
I wanted to just thank Jim for all the work he did at EC Fiber. If I remember, I did that in the
And Cheryl.
Yeah.
And Cheryl.
Well, it's really gathering steam now. They've been able to float a few bond issues because they're, as they get more customers, they get more money, they look better in the bond market, and the thing is growing. It's finally catching on and really going.
And it doesn't get public tax money.
Not a dime. Not a bit of liability.
Right.
What you're going to get is better real estate values.
And as more people sign up, the price actually is supposed to go down because it's a nonprofit. They don't pay high salaries. It's going to be a great thing. Okay, I guess that's it. Okay. Our select board report you can find on page 8. I'm not going to read it all to you, but I'll go through the main highlights. I want to thank Norm Arsenault, who's our FEMA coordinator. Does is after the coordinator is unbelievable. You all remember Irene? We did Bus Road this year, which was the last Irene project, closed it all out last year. We're still waiting for the money to come in from FEMA and the state. Okay, and then lo and behold, we're not even done with that yet. And July 1st, we got whacked. Okay, you've got 2 slides in the town, one on post office, one on West Hill, and you've got a culvert up at Connecticut Trail. That a bridge, whatever they decide. We have not heard anything back from them, really. We're just starting to get some information on how to fix those. That's gonna run $500,000 for those 3 projects, close to it. So, you know, it's an incredible amount of paperwork and all, and the things constantly change, so thank you so much. Absolutely. We saved the town a bunch of money by working with Short Hill Ski Club, and we put a bridge up. The bridge washed out up on Kennedy Road, and we were able to use the Short Hills Road that they had, it's going to be called Short Hills Way, that we had public hearings and went through the whole process, and they were very, very gracious to donate that Class 4 section, so we saved $25,000-$30,000 on a bridge on McDonald Road. So that was great to work with the Short Hills Ski Club. So if you see any of those guys, thank you. We had a special town meeting in October about the post office, renovating the town clerk office, and that went through incredibly, you know, 34-7, I think the vote was, and we're still working with the post office. We've signed a lease 6 or 8 weeks ago because of some current litigation that's going on. It's been held up a little bit, but I just have heard today that we should have a signed back lease in the next week or so. So hopefully that happens. And there's so much bureaucracy, you know, in federal government. The lawsuit that we had was to gain access to the Elmwood Cemetery extension, the lot behind the cemetery. We went through public hearings. We had a discussion about the road that wanted to go right through where the town clerk building is. We denied the petition initially. Then we went back and said, okay, it's for access. We opened it up again, we warned it, we did a petition, we honored that petition for the public hearing, and again, denied, they sued us for access to the back of Elmwood Cemetery. The litigation is going on now for since last summer, really, and the Cemetery Commission, thank you, got together and finally decided that there's unencumbered access right through the center of that cemetery to the back. There's a 12-foot wide, you can see a little road in there, it's unencumbered all the way back. So the Cemetery Commission this summer is gonna put more of a through access area through the bank there so that they can get, so anybody can get back into that extension area. I wish the lawsuit was over. This lawsuit is now costing us up to $20,000 already in legal fees. So, you know, it's, we filed now for summary judgment. There's really no case law that substantiates the claim, and I feel that they've gotten what they sued us for. There were some other things about open meeting law. We agreed that we didn't get our minutes up in 5 days. It's very tough. The state says you've got to have 5 calendar days to get draft minutes up from a public meeting, any public meeting. Diane Aramo's done a great job with that, but she's out of town, and that's what happened. She was the only one that could post our minutes. We, Kathy and I now have sat down with her, and Kathy can post those minutes right away. So we've agreed that there's been a problem, and we rectified the problem with training. So hopefully the we'll have that settled soon, I really do hope. The good news about our property taxes are that our school tax with the unified district, a lot of you weren't here just before, but we have now united with Hancock to make one district of all tuition kids. We'll have about 100 kids between the two towns that have their choice to go to any school, any accredited school. Our tax rate last year went way up for education to $1.85 from $1.30 or so, and we got whacked worse than anybody in the state. This year, with the unified district, we will be voting on May 8th. Both Hancock and Granville will have one meeting, and our tax rate for the unified district looks like it's going to go down at least 25 cents. So we're going to, the projection right now is like $1.58. So from $1.85 this year to $1.58, that's over 25 cent reduction in our property tax for the schools, which is great news for us, believe me. And the school board will be made up of 3 people from Granville, 3 people from Hancock. I'm out. And thank you very much, Julie, for stepping in on that one. But it should work real smoothly after that. The toughest thing the school board has, is to make sure that kids are residents of Granville. With single families and, you know, single parents and, you know, kids living with relatives or friends, that's the hardest thing that the school board has to do, is make sure that those kids live in town. And it's a difficult thing, and I want to thank Mark, who's gone out and checked on a few, but every year we have 2 or 3 people that are trying to get free tuition from us, and we've been pretty aggressive to watch that. The biggest thing that we're going to get to real soon is our roads. And we had to go out multiple times to get bids for our winter plow. Griffin has done a great job this winter, I think. You know, we've got a little complaint, we had to go out 4 times to get a bid that we finally could take to get our winter roads plowed. So we'll talk about that coming up in another article, but it gets more and more difficult to get contractors to do what we need to be done in town. So we'll get to that too. So,
Gene has a question.
Yes, Bruce, could you assure us that the address for the post office lease that we saw in the draft will be corrected?
4801 will be corrected.
Oh, good.
Yes, sir. No, they had one on one address that didn't exist.
Yeah.
So I don't know where they got it from. That's
the address.
Thank you.
Any other questions from the select board or? I'd entertain a motion.
I do. Oh. So the last 2 years, our taxes went up so much just because of education?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes. Town tax this year is 61 cents and we're not paying it. Our school tax went up 40 cents a month. And the reason the school tax went up is because we had the lowest tax rate for education from the 10 towns for the last 15 years. Okay, and the reason we did is because in 2000, 2001, we had 72 kids in Granville. Okay, that number dropped to 22 10 years later. Now we're back up over 50. And the state held harmless that big drop in students. So we were getting credit for phantom students, kids that weren't there, that the state was paying us for to keep our taxes artificially low. So we got whacked this year because all of a sudden our number went up and crossed that threshold and we paid the piper.
Okay.
But now with the unified district, we're going down at least 25 cents.
Thank you.
And we'll know more. Every meeting we go to, we find out if a family moved in, a family moved out. So it changes all the time, so it's tough to get a budget. That's why the budget will be May 8th, it'll be in Hancock at 6 o'clock, it'll be the second Tuesday of May every year for the school budget. So we won't have a school budget town meeting.
If this, two towns come together, is Rochester still closing?
Rochester's closing the Midland High School. Then we've got a school choice. They unified the Stockbridge.
Stockbridge?
Yep. And Bethel and Royalton are together now, and the high school will be in Royalton, middle school will be in Bethel.
I have a question about the road company that you guys want to start for your town road. Well, this is for the select board. This is directly to you guys. I don't know, I've been in the business for quite a while now. Everything keeps going up and up and up. And I don't know where the idea of starting your own road company, why you think that's going to be cheaper. My costs keep getting bigger. This is for you guys to mull over. This isn't, we'll talk about it later when the.
Well, it's been, we're going to get to that warning article real soon. It's been very difficult. You know, I'm not 100% off, you know, sure it's going to work either. But we'll talk about that in a lot of detail just a minute.
Yep.
Yeah, we could, that'll be enough.
Right.
Thank you, but certainly it's somewhat appropriate to ask now to be part of the selection.
Right, well, this is the question.
Well, the select board is proposing the next warrant article down there.
Any?
I move that we accept the selectman's report.
I second.
Judy seconds. And everyone in favor of moving the selectman's report, accepting it?
Yes.
Say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Well, we'll go on to the four. Judy's moved Article 4.
I second.
Kim second. Article 4 reads, shall the voters of Granville approve a budget of $199,800 to purchase road equipment and hire a full-time road foreman to perform the necessary road work for the fiscal year starting July 1st, 2018? And now it's open for discussion, so we can also continue.
Do you want me to go over the presentation? Or?
Yeah.
If there's no objection, I want to make sure that we have an open discussion on both the proposal for a highway department, and that's on page 9. And if you turn to the town worksheet on page 13, you'll see the road portion the way we normally do it. Okay, so I think both are germane to the discussion tonight, and if anybody has questions on either of those at this point, if this passes, we will no longer do the road budget on page 13. This will take the place of that road budget. Okay? As I said, we've had a lot of trouble getting contractors to do the work at the right time, at the right time. And it's been very challenging to do that. I want to say right up front, if this passes, it doesn't mean we're automatically doing it. If this passes, the first thing we'll do in the next, we have a select board meeting on Monday night next week. We will go over an advertisement for a road foreman. If we do not get the good road foreman, we will call another special town meeting. That's off, we're going back to the open, okay? The next circuit breaker on this thing is if we can't get the equipment that we need at the price that's in our budget, we will then, all bets off, have a special town meeting and go back to the old way. I want everybody to understand that. Yep.
About the old way, that price for the winter plowing and everything, that was a 1-year contract, right?
I'm sorry, winter contract's 1 year.
With Griffin is a 1-year contract.
Yes, sir.
And you put the same number in for last year for their bid.
We will get to that. You're right. And their bid could be $20,000 higher, easily. Depends on what happens in March. We will invite Griffin and Griffin, depends on how the vote goes tonight, we'll invite Griffin and Griffin in next week's conference. Okay?
Victoria.
Why was it only a one-year contract? It's usually a three.
Because that's all we could get.
It was a one bid.
We went out for bid four times. The fourth time we went out for bid, we asked for a lump sum price. They gave us a $44,000 winter price. If it didn't show it all winter, we paid $44,000.
Isn't it?
The other bidders that we had were in the $80,000 and up range. So we ended up paying $44,000 this year, which was about the same as we paid last year.
Okay, you go ahead.
Yeah, and we're going to have to keep East Granville separate, right?
Yes, sir. So anyway, what I'd like to do is just go over a couple of things why this might make sense. And like I said, there's an awful lot of question after this, but I think it might be the right time to try it. And, if we had a town employee, it could happen. We could have good things when it happens. You know, the other day when we had, 2 weeks ago, when we had 70-degree weather and the mud was this thick, and then it went down to 10 degrees or whatever that night, thank God Harvest came down here and graded it at 4 o'clock in the morning. Because otherwise, and they told us the grader wasn't going to work for 2 or 3 days. So if they didn't get out there before that froze solid, it would still be a huge mess. If we had our own equipment, our own guy, he'd be out there, okay? We wouldn't have to wait for a contractor to fit us in. You know, sometimes when the roads get graded, it's not the best time, but it's the only time they could do it, you know? When we cut down the side vegetation, a lot of people like to get it cut earlier, so you get rid of some of the invasives. We could do that more than once and be able to do that with a town employee. Down trees. Thank goodness the fire department will go out there after a bad storm and cut up our trees. Thank you very much. But, again, a town employee would be able to do that. Road grading is done when you need it. Right now, we've had road signs that have been sitting around. We're trying to get a contract to put road signs in. They're like $120 a sign. You know, we could have our road guy go out there and put up those signs.
Isn't that usually the road commissioner's job?
The road commissioner does not do that. He is not able to do any of that work. Okay? We have a line item in the road budget. We have some road commissioners did, thank you, Jim. Okay? But he didn't get paid for it. And it wasn't part of his job. And I'll tell you, roads have gotten so much more complicated with permitting, with, there's a general permit out there now. All the ditching that you see with the rock line, all that stuff is required by the state. It costs the town's money. Cleaning the culverts, we never do. That doesn't happen. If we had somebody go out and clean some culverts down here, we'd probably alleviate a lot of the flooding. We have over 300 culverts in this town, and a lot of them need to be repaired. Again, we can do that with the road guy that can go out there and do it. Mowing the roadside, like I said, the town person would be able to go out and work during the storm and get some of the work done. We might have been able to save, like, Post Office Hill Slide this year with the town employee out there in the storm. We might have been able to get that shored up so we didn't have to spend what the state's making us spend to do it, you know? We could have perhaps done that. We'd have somebody that would be able to work more directly with the state and FEMA on some of these projects. Send an employee to training and understand all of the regulations that are coming on right now. Kevin does a great job doing that, but we would be able to do that more. A full-time employee to do sanding and plowing, and somebody that we could direct. At this point, we would not hire a road commissioner. This person, if we were to select somebody, would be managed by the selector.
I have two questions, and I don't know anything about roads, so if I sound ignorant, I'm sorry.
You live on one.
I do live on one. The first is, would you be hiring, would this person, this be like their designated job?
This would be a full-time job.
They wouldn't be allowed to work on other people's roads.
No.
And you could guarantee that would be true.
Salary commission.
It doesn't mean that.
No, you mean
people
so that
work on the sidewalk. I'm just hearing you say that, everything could happen, this person would be there.
Right.
Like, because this is the only command you're doing. So you're saying that we would guarantee that's the only job that they would have is this job.
This would be a full-time job, and that's a good point, because right now contractors do all kinds of other things. And we could be
I have one more question, if that's okay. The second question is, if we needed more than one person on the job, because one person, it's hard for one person to do all the things you're talking about, would that come out of their salary, or is there money for that?
We put $2,500 in for backup person.
$2,500
for $900. Well, yeah, I mean, you know, you're going to pay $20 an hour, or whatever. It would be somebody that could, if somebody got hurt or got sick, I mean, you know, you'd have a backup person for that.
Marilyn.
So if this person is working the 8 hours during the day up to 40, and then at 3 o'clock they have to get up and grade the roads because Harvey, you don't need them anymore. And then there's snow and ice again, and then he's plowing, and then he's up at 8 to come back to work for
just like a road crew in town.
Five. So one person is going to
be 16 miles of road. There's 16 miles of road that we take care of. And one person definitely could do 60 miles a
day. How many people are doing it now with when the...
Right. Most of the time, one contractor comes with one truck to plow the roads.
Because when we walked down the ball mill, we saw like two of these Griffin and Griffin guys. Is that...
Sometimes Griffin and Griffin might send down three trucks. But it's not necessary most of the time. It's not necessary.
But by the time you get through...
It takes about 2 hours to do 16 miles. So if you've got snow going at 4 inches an hour, you're in trouble no matter who you are.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Sean has something to say, and then I'll go to the other Sean.
You know, we looked at a bunch of other towns that had road crews that were small. Pittsfield has 16 miles of road. They've had a guy doing it for, 10 years or something, and their budget's right in with what budget we have here. So it can be done, and BLCT's talked about some other towns that are having really good luck with it. So I was, you know, questioning it myself, and Bruce at the beginning wasn't even on board at all. And he started looking at it. He looked at some trucks with Kevin, and he thinks it might work. I think it might work, but
if it doesn't work, we're not doing it. If you don't find the right person to take the job, and I looked into the labor laws a little bit too, and you can't put a person on a fixed salary and expect them to work 80 hours one week and 20 hours the next. Everything over 40 hours is the overtime. In order to have a fixed salary, if somebody goes and works like that, you got to have at least two people that they manage. We can have one person total that would run this.
Okay? Sean,
there's going to be a backup there.
I'm sorry. Sean has a question, then we're going to go to Ken and Jen.
It's more like a statement.
Yeah.
Like, I don't believe that one person can do all this work at one time. And second, you're going to be spending $175,000 with interest on trucks, and you're going to let them sit outside. If it's 20 below or zero, how are you going to work on them? How are you going to transport them? What are you going to do with the oil? What are you going to do with the fluids coming out of it? Are you going to put them in the firehouse? Pull the fire engines out and have them freeze up if you have to work on them? It's just, and as we sit here, correct me, Daniel, if he's here, I believe this building's condemned up on top. Can't we use some resources to put, fix the building that's fallen down instead of buying old trucks?
My thought is the equipment, you can hustle the equipment up easy enough. But
let me just say, not to interrupt, but on the equipment, this is a good time because a lot of the bigger towns and cities, they keep a truck for 3 or 5 years and they get rid of it.
Right.
So right after town meeting is when a lot of these good used vehicles come right on the market. And you know, a 5-year-old truck is not a piece of crap. That'll last another 10 years if it's kept up.
Right. No, I agree with that. The equipment is the easy part. I think your employee is going to be your hardest part of this whole thing.
I totally agree.
And your workman's comp is just going to eat you alive.
We're the municipal, we're covered by Vermont Legal Cities and Towns. So all of that is built into the budget.
So, excuse me, Jim is next in line, and then Mike.
Okay, what's that? Let me start with you.
I have a difficult time voting for this because of the lack of information in terms of detail. You talk about a number where we're going to pay $80,000 with benefits. We don't have a job description. We really know what he's going to do.
You're on the select board now. We'll have that next Monday. I was not going to put all this together.
Why the rush is my thought. Okay, you know, when I heard about this thing going down, I thought, well, they'll be worked on. Maybe, you know, a year after this. It's too premature. It's not well prepared. There's no consideration of overtime. In the wintertime, it's going to cost you a lot more. It's going to have a lot of time just because of the way the season is. In the summertime, he's going to be straight out. Can you imagine his job? Now, he's going to spread 2,500 yards of gravel, right? He's got a grader to do it. He's got a truck to haul. So he shows up, I guess they're parked out somewhere behind the sand pile. It's his room.
There's no room.
And now what's he going to do? How's he get up there? How's he get two vehicles up there so he can work the two vehicles and get them back at night? The efficiency in numbers, scale, means a lot. That's how this society has become what it is today.
Michael.
Let me finish.
I'm sorry.
I got 2 minutes, right? You got your clock going?
Five minutes.
Okay.
Five minutes.
You won't hear from me the rest of the night.
No, I mean,
I can see in the future that perhaps Hancock and Tom Randall, as a combined effort, it's a road crew. Yeah, I know you're shaking your head because I heard about the meetings, but things are changing. The fire department's going to end up combining at some point in time, and you know, we're going to get closer to it. But
here's
what I'd like to say is my bottom line, by getting interrupted again, is that I do not feel comfortable voting for something that I have so little information on. The overtime is not in there. You're going to be over budget. The workman's comp is not there. That person, you know, just the mechanics of doing it. Imagine any one of you sitting around here trying to get 2,500 yards of gravel up there and spread. It's probably going to take you a month, and we don't want to be inconvenienced because, you know, it's not great at all. When I used to do it, I'd have a grader and a minimum of 3 trucks, sometimes 5, so we whip through and it wasn't any convenient. That's all I'm saying.
Just a couple of points. This would be a full-time job. This would be paid on the hour, and we may not be able to get the person that we need and by the rate that we can pay, and factor in that overtime. Because you are going to have to pay time and a half overtime over 40 hours, okay? And some of that can be divided up into comp time during slow time. Yes, you can do it, okay? It can be in the contract up front. I've already checked into this. You can do time and a half comp time and do it at a time when the town doesn't need the services, okay?
Now, who'd you talk to?
I talked to the Department of Labor.
So did I. That's not the story I got. So we'll get straight out.
I wish I had the second 552 yet. We'll talk later.
I'd like to move on to Michael's head. Thank you. I know the select board spent a lot of time reviewing this. I know Bruce has. I know you all have. And I think one thing that will help, if you just ask that person to spread open his jacket so you can see his chest. There should be a big red S on it.
Yeah.
Because that's the only person. I mean, that's an incredible agenda. You know, it's just, but I think you got to start somewhere.
We have Dennis back there, and then Victoria, and then Judy.
What was the name of the people that did the winter roads this year? Griffin
and Griffin.
Are there any representatives here from Griffin and Griffin? Because I would like to thank them. I've lived up there for a lot of years, and the roads have never been better. This year, roads with, in the ice we had, all the ice we had, it's been a tough year. And the roads have never been better through the winter in all the years I've been here.
I agree.
Thank you, Roger. So, kind of branching off of what Dennis just said, the roads have been absolutely terrific this year. If we expect that level of service to continue from whether it's a contractor or a road crew that we might have, then we need to provide the same equipment and the same personnel to provide that service. It would stand to reason, right? So in speaking with some of these guys that are doing our roads this year, they've told me that there are quite a few weeks through this winter that both drivers have put in 60 plus hours in a week. So for the proposal to come across that one person is gonna be able to put in 120 hours a week to keep, that's completely outrageous.
We've got the hours from here to the
south. Let's have the, what are you guys?
Well, how does Pittsfield do with that? They have one guy.
They have the help of,
they have one guy that does it, he cleans all the equipment.
He's not the only one doing it. When he needs help, he calls in.
And we have a backup person in the budget. We have a backup.
For $2,500, which isn't realistic. Can I speak now?
Yeah, you and then Richard will comment and then.
Even if this is a good idea or an idea to comment, okay. I think the figures that we have, yeah, and the way it's just not complete enough, I think, to make it a real good decision, and I would move to table it.
Griffin and Griffin probably had to spend a good many hours coming all the way down from Duxbury. They are in Northfield, but they keep the equipment in Duxbury. And we had great reservations about that when we hired them to do the job. It was their reputation that brought it through. And as you just said, they've done a tremendous job.
Yeah,
they've done the best job I've seen since I've been here. And who's to say we're going to have next year?
It's worth a bump up of money to me.
Maybe a bump up. Maybe they say, listen, we don't really want to be in the plow business.
We do construction.
Yeah, so if you're looking for certainty, you're not going to find it anywhere, really. If we can get somebody, what I think Bruce is saying was, it really revolves around finding the right person to spearhead this and do it. And if we had any doubts or any reservations about that at all, we would not waste that on the town. It'd have to be just the right person. One other aside is that with Kevin, we had a fellow from Vermont Rural Roads down here. These people are retired road foremen. They've done it all their life. The state pays them to come around and talk to towns about the issue. And we were at it for a few hours. We went over many, many details. And he said, I can't say that. And I remember his bottom line was, he said, your town probably won't save a lot of money, but you'll get much better service if you can get the right person. So, there's this in there, and I think we want to proceed very carefully, not to get in trouble. We definitely wouldn't go ahead unless we felt we had the right kind of personnel in place.
Kevin, did you have something?
Yeah, I just want to say, as far as Griffin goes, for hours, those guys are not doing just grand. They're doing numerous other jobs, and if you're working 60 or 80 hours a week, that time is definitely not all grand. Other jobs that they are doing, and we've had instances where we've had slippery roads. I've gotten a call from the state police or from the resident. I've called them, and they're out doing something else. It's 2 hours before they get here, and it's not their fault. I'm not discrediting them at all, but that's a long time for us to wait for the contractor to get here.
Judy,
since this does seem to center on finding the right person. What, I don't see that if we were to vote for this, moving ahead with this, we're not committed to anything. It's a vote to say, yes, pursue this. And as Bruce said, if we don't find the right person, all bets are off. Is that accurate?
We would have another special town meeting to...
Right, so it would entail some more town meetings, but voting for this article is just giving the go-ahead to pursue these possibilities. It's not locking us into that situation.
I'll tell you, it's a lot more work for the select board, too, to proceed with this than to do it when we've done it in the past.
Kate, then Jim, and then Mary.
Well, Jim already spoke a long time. I'd like to go before Jim.
I was going to say Kate.
Well, Mary can speak before me. I've also already spoken. I agree.
Go ahead.
Oh, thank you.
No, fine.
Oh, I just want to say that Judy and I have been attending select board meetings for months. And most of you have not, but I've seen them go through this in great detail. And those of you who are saying it's not well thought out, I can tell you that it is. And they may not have put everything on paper here, but they've done a very careful job in looking into this. And I told that to you, Jim, at the last select board meeting. You came to that meeting and you said, where's the detail? And we said to you, well, where were you the last select board meeting and the last one before that? I mean, they've been going through a lot. And I think, if anything, I would like to give them a chance to follow through with this because they've worked their butts off on this plan. And like Judy said, it's not tying us to anything. It just means they're going to look for this person and see if they can line up this guy with the S on his shirt. If they can't, then we go back to the regular budget.
Hey,
Kate.
So just to be very clear, in the scenario that the two of you are talking about, and the select board has suggested, there wouldn't be any buying of equipment, for instance, when it all goes on sale in March, until they knew that they had the person. The cart is... Mm-hmm. The horse is the guy, the cart is the equipment, and I just want to know that that's what the selection is.
First thing we need to do is advertise for a position, see what we get.
So we're not going to go and look for that equipment.
And $80,000 with benefits is our ceiling on what we would be able to do, and that's a good job in this area.
That's a great job.
If the person has the kind of expertise, well, you're going to have to break down on it. It's
$25. Also, if the person has the expertise we're looking for, we want his value judgment on the equipment.
We did entertain Robin's questioning.
Okay, so could you stop talking? Yeah. Should we call the order on
this? Yeah, you guys over there, please. It's really distracting.
Sorry.
Your voice is bounced up over the wall, so when someone speaking, please. You can go outside and talk. Thank you. Rob.
Okay, so basically the select board wants the ability to take all of this into consideration, test some of these scenarios which has to do with equipment and trying to hire somebody. Now, my next question is, what's your timeline? I mean, because there has to be a flip at some point, because you're in essence saying, okay, this is what we'd like to propose, but we want the chance to try and investigate it, see how far we can go with it. And then at the same time, we have a budget two pages over that would then, it would be one or the other. So we're saying, give us the opportunity to investigate this, and then we won't have a discussion on the other budget. Is this correct? And then, but then it seems to me there needs to be a timeline and possibly even another meeting to allow us all to understand what's going to happen and what you're about.
What we would do is next Monday night we'll go over a job description and a advertisement for the road foreman. We would put that in the paper right away. We'd let it go out there for a few weeks, see what candidates we get, bring them in for interviews. This position would start July 1st. If we found the right person, the next thing to do is to take that person and look for the equipment. okay? If we pass the first hurdle at 9, the guy with yes on it, and I agree, it's a tough job, but it's a good paying job, okay?
But that doesn't mean.
If we find the right person that can do the job, okay, that we're confident in, the next step is to go and get this equipment that we need. So if we don't find the right person, we'll have a special town meeting to go back to the other budget. If we find the right person and we can't get the right equipment in that budget, again, so this has to be all done in the next 2 months or so. So, you know, we'll know long before July 1st.
I'm going to take Sean, because he hasn't spoken on this particular subject, and then Ken and Ken.
Did I just hear you say if we find the right person, then if we can't get the equipment, then it's over? So this person that you would find, they're going to have like a 5-year lease, but then if you can't get the equipment, you haven't got a 5-year lease.
This person would be hired with knowing that we would have to go out and find equipment, okay? It would not be a paid job to go out and help us find the equipment. And so he would start paying, well, July 1st.
Quick question, just from an over. Who would quit their job for this job?
Yeah, you don't really care.
You let Sean respond to Sean.
I'm really tired, because there's like a bunch of rumors going around about we're just going to give Kevin Bagley the job. We're going to interview the best person we can get. This is based on money that these guys make in the garage, okay? So, you know, it's $25 an hour. There's a lot of other things included. There's workman's comp, there's retirement, and other things. So, but the base salaries are $25 an hour. And that's not a lot of money. I can't make a living on $25 an hour.
But the benefits, a lot of us do. Yeah,
Ken, and then Ken.
I think somebody needs to rein you guys in a little bit. I don't like either scenario of your budget for your road or your budget for your new town road company. Your road company is, you're trying to make it look like it's going to be better than the town road budget. Well, the town road budget is way out of range already. The town roads, yeah, they're great this winter. Cost a lot of money for sand, a lot of money to plow them. I think that needs to be reined in. I don't think you need the extra sand pile. I don't think you need the extra $12,000 worth of gravel. I don't think you need the extras that keep going into our budget. I think perhaps if you could get your roads done a little bit cheaper, everybody could maybe put up with it a little bit. Maybe the roads don't get sanded every time there's a half an inch of snow. Maybe every time there's a little bit of a rut, maybe the road foreman can go out with a York rake instead of having a grader come and charge us. I think it's way out of proportion for the size of our town and for the size of our pocketbooks. We're not Pittsfield. Pittsfield has a big grand list compared to ours.
I don't argue with anything that you're saying. I agree with you, okay? And the problem is that we get so few people willing to do the work as a contractor. We've had more and more difficulty.
How come?
Right.
How come?
I really don't know.
I can tell you why.
Okay.
Because some of the specifics on the contracts are so whacked that none of the contractors can fit the bill of the contract.
Thank you. Give me another question.
I'm not done yet.
Sorry.
Okay, we'll give you one more minute.
I'll be quiet.
Be discussing back and forth. So you make a statement, the select board answers, and then we go on to the next statement.
Well, I wasn't done making my statement.
No, well,
I'm
sorry. I hope everybody gets their news out.
It's like this picture on the front of this piece of paper here. That is a great development. It looks like a development to me with the stone line ditches. It doesn't look like a town road that I'm used to in Granville. You know, it's not the old country lane that used to go up through there. It's not, I mean, it's got stone line ditches and they're on the flat. We've got stone line ditches that have been replaced the other stone line ditches that were in there for not that long.
I don't know why we're gonna keep throwing money at it. Keep taking apart what's already been done and making it look like it's developed. Now we're done.
We're done? No, there's gonna be the last question and you can respond.
Now, I want to say that we don't all have trucks. For those of us sedans supporting the roads are passable. And, you know, this month we had a couple weeks ago, it's been unfortunate to get my car cleaned up. I mean, because we got bottomed out. You know, trucks are great, but we don't all have them. So they need to be somewhat passable. Perfect.
Just to respond quickly to the stone line ditches, those are requirements in the state.
I know.
Warren, you oversaw that project. Tell me if we're wrong.
We put them in, they're required by the state of Vermont.
Yep. And you're gonna see more and more of it because with the clean water initiatives, they're requiring that all the time.
On
top of what percent greater? 5% or greater.
Does anybody else say that that's about that much?
5% is 5%, yeah. You can measure it on one offer.
There's a lot of them around the shop.
I'd like to make that discussion cease.
Are we calling the question?
We're calling the question, yes.
I second that.
Make a motion, we table it.
Well, she called the question.
And I seconded the call.
And she seconded the call. So we have to vote on that first. If we continue discussion, then let's see how this would work. Let me see if I can make this clear. You called the question, seconded. You vote on calling the question. If it's voted down, we can discuss tabling it. Because you came a little late on that. Sorry. So we have Cheryl called the question. Yes?
Just point of order.
Yeah.
Just what is the, is a majority vote here?
Two-thirds.
It's two-thirds to call the question.
Two-thirds. So it has to be a hand.
Right, so it's not just simple majority, it's two-thirds to call the question. And then, so.
We had 48 people vote in the select, I don't know if we had the same number here, but if we were to get two-thirds, it would have to be a hand vote in order for us to figure out what two-thirds are.
Correct, right.
That's so only voters, I guess.
Yes, certainly only voters.
So does someone with a quick math mind know?
32.
Perfect. Okay, so the motion has been made to call the question. It's been seconded. Everybody in favor of calling the question, raise your hand. So you can vote. I can't vote.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26.
Oh. Please, if you'll stand up.
Stand up, stand up.
If you want to call the question,
let's just call the question.
Stand up now.
They already voted.
Oh,
it's
not.
It's not.
No.
It's not. It's not. It's about 28-7.
Yeah. What's that?
The question is
they call. We're voting.
Okay.
We're voting on the.
Okay.
So the question.
article one more time. So Article 4, we're voting. Shall the voters of Granville approve a budget of $199,800 to purchase road equipment and hire a full-time road foreman to perform the necessary road work for the fiscal year starting July 1st, 2018?
I'd like to recommend that we do a paper ballot.
Second. Okay.
So if you write yes on it, then you are approving of this. If you write no, you are rejecting the article.
Is this as much fun as Rochester?
Yes.
What about the
$20,000, your cost of the town, you're gonna add that to it too?
That's not germane to this conversation.
You don't really have to be a sore loser.
I'm not a sore loser. I congratulate you there.
Is there another question?
Is there a motion?
No, there's not official motion.
No.
Can Kevin speak to the prices?
I didn't see him raise his hand.
No, I'm asking, can he speak?
Oh, sure, you have a question for Kevin, sure.
Yeah, can he just explain some of the increases and why?
The dust control is also sweeping pavement and applying to the roads. And the grading, we've been over budget every single year. We have this argument every year when we go to budget time about grading. The rate goes up and people want the roads taken care of. So that's what the actual budget is. We're always over budget on grading. This brings it up to where the number meets what they actually use now.
Vivian, next.
Dirt roads require grading. You want to have your road graded occasionally to do the prep of your car.
Oh, Jim, I'm sorry.
Okay, a couple of comments. One being that this is the guideline, if I understand, for the select board. In other words, the select board is pretty much looking at the bottom line. And then, you know, if you get a lot of storms, you got to grade twice as much, then you do that, but you find a way, what else are we not going to do? In other words, say priorities. So line item by line item can get real tough to try and pass the motions without really all night for line item. I would suggest that people want to adjust things, having to adjust the bottom line or the roads or the bottom line to the municipality. And that basically sets the select board to manage it.
Right, that's a good thing. It brings up that the town budget generally is a guideline for the selectmen. They can spend it however they seem fit. Jim, did I kind of
They can't cross over, take road money and spend it on municipal or vice versa.
No, you can municipal roads.
Oh, okay.
They can.
But not roads from municipal, right?
Right. And I was amazed to see that we have a 25% increase in our road budget last year.
Our actual spending last year was $187,000.
Not $167,000.
No, our budget was $167,000 and we spent a year end $187,000.
Okay. Now, okay, so we're talking 2 years ago.
We're talking the year that ended in June of last year.
Yeah, right. Okay, well, even so, I think that, you know, we're really getting out of hand here with a 208% increase in the road commissioners.
Well, the road, if I can, I don't know if you're done, Jim, I don't need to interrupt.
No, go ahead. There you go.
Okay, if you want to go down to the road commissioner, we put a new line item in there of $2,500 to allow our road commissioner to go out and get paid $20 an hour or whatever to clean some culverts, to do some things. Right now, the road commissioner's stipend is totally separate. And that is, I mean, Kevin does a great job, I think, of dealing with all the contracting that we do, of dealing with all the permitting that we have to get, dealing with all of the rocks and ditches and stuff that you have to follow. He does all that stuff for his stipend, okay? He does not have any ability to go out and clean culverts, cut up trees, you know, do that kind of stuff. So we put a token amount in there that we could have for an hourly wage. You can take that out, you know, I mean, you know, but we thought it was good to have that in there so that we could have some in-house help. And that is related to the supplies. These would be town supplies. They might be a chainsaw. They would be owned by the town. A couple of shovels. It's not big equipment. And that would again be so that we could get some things done in-house. Putting up signs would be something that he could do for, instead of $120 an hour, $20 or $25.
Okay, the mileage, I did a quick calculation here. And that at 53 cents a mile, I'm not sure, but that's pretty close to what you're paying. That's 4,717 miles. If he drove the speed limit, it'd take him 113 hours to get that mileage back. I mean, that seems just like off the top. But
last year we spent $1,900.
Well, I mean, I assume he fills out a timesheet that
does,
so you know what
he's
you have.
He's also have a lot, I'm sorry.
Yes, you are. Okay, I guess the other thing I would add that I know a little bit about is permits. That $3,000 is a bogus number. I know why you did it, because that's what you were told originally, but that's all the legal. I spoke with our senator just last Monday, and he said, yeah, it's ridiculous that town of Granville can pay $3,000 for the permit. This is for the water quality thing. And the town of Burlington will pay $3,000 for their permit. The Senate is quite aware that this does not cut it. So
you know that, okay, so that's the background, that basically that's a mandated amount. You gotta get a general permit. Every culvert we do now, we have to get a wetlands permit because they're all in wetlands. And you gotta pay, what is it, 75 cents a square foot or something for a permit?
Plus
other costs. But the permitting has just gone through the roof. That's why we put a line item on permit. And it totally is unfair. Because you're right, it doesn't matter on the population or the amount of roads you have, they're giving us a fixed amount. Kevin, is that?
$2,400 a year to the state of Waltham.
For the general permit.
For the general permit. And then the number that I was told as of recently was $200 per culvert.
For what to get
right. Permit. Yeah, okay. I mean, these are all things that are still in the flux.
No, that's
not. That's the law now. They can change it. That's the law now.
Well, you know, there's just been a long regulation.
Okay, that's the regulation. This right. Legislature could override that this year. I wouldn't care.
Okay. Yeah, just seeing 25% in 1 year is like.
My question to the site board is on the plowing and the sanding, is if the bids. Since you guys voted down to the road crew and the bids come out more than the total for the plow and the sanding, are you guys gonna have to come back to the taxpayers and ask for more money?
We will not have to, no we won't. We'll have to take what we can get.
So
it will be adjusted on the tax bill the next year.
Or we can amend it.
What's that?
Or we can amend the amount now.
Oh, you can amend the amount now, absolutely. But he's saying if it goes way up, if it goes way up, what do? We need a special town meeting, and the answer is no. We could run a $50,000 deficit because we can't get the contractors to do the work, and that would go on to the next year's tax bill when we figure out the tax rate.
Yeah, I had a question about the FEMA match, the $10,000. Is that in anticipation of FEMA projects, or is that?
We put that line item in there first time this year because we have about $500,000 worth of work that needs to get done. Hopefully FEMA's gonna come through and say they're gonna help. They haven't said that, okay? But we gotta get the work done. We gotta fix the slides, we gotta fix that broken culvert on the Connecticut Trail. If we don't get FEMA help, we're gonna have to take out a bond for the town to fix those things, okay? The best that we can hope for is that the town will have to pay 12.5% of those storm damage, that storm damage. So 12.5% on, you know, $60,000. So this is just a little bit of money to put in there to try to, you know, cover some of the FEMA match costs. That's a scary part of FEMA. Just go ahead.
Robin?
I'd just like to make a point. This is regardless of who's road crew commissioner or anything. I mean, I just like people to understand that what you're moving towards in this situation is a paid position within the town. And it used to be that we had a road commissioner that got paid, and I could be wrong with this number, $1,200
to do the same thing, sort of. I know regulations have changed. That is happening now, and every year we keep adding more perks, more bennies, more expenses to the taxpayers. I mean, when you do the numbers, as Jim touched on, and it's funny, I mean, you know, I work numbers, so I did the same calculation he did. I sat here and I said, well, that would mean I'd have to drive from here to Waitsfield 148 times to get that amount of mileage. And if you do it based on the 16 miles of roads that we have, you'd have to drive all of our roads 300 times. Okay, so, and I'm just, I know that this is like, but I mean, you people are the select people of this community, which is a very important position in this community, and you make a lot of decisions for all of us and the taxpayers. You haven't had an increase in your positions since I came here over 30 years ago. So where, how have we lost the perspective of the road commissioner being a person that does volunteer a lot of their time, just like I audited and never got paid for it? I mean, or no, we got a stipend, we got some small amount, but it doesn't matter. You do it because you care about your community and you want to do something for your community. And now all of a sudden, we're making it a paid position and it's costing us money.
Marilyn?
It's been mentioned a couple of times, the mileage issue, and my question is, are there some kind of mileage reports that the road commissioner fills out, or is it just that's a given and I get my check at the end of the year for all those miles, or is there a little piece of paper where I used to work and you know, I drove around the vehicle that I was given for the day. When I went back to the office, I had to write down what towns I went to, how many miles I put on, and it took probably 20 seconds to fill that form out, and it kept everyone honest. And so, you know, it also is accurate, like so much gas was used or whatever. I'm just asking, is there a mileage certificate or some, not, you know, some kind of mileage form that you
all the mileage is accurate, yes.
This John.
I don't think anybody's really understanding though. Kevin had a lot of stuff to do with FEMA. I saw him on his days off with the guys, with you know the Department of Transportation, and he put a lot of driving in the last couple of years, the last few FEMA accidents. But you know he really works hard. And, I don't think anybody gives him enough credit, but that's just me.
This is going to meetings. This is, you know, going out when we look at trucks and stuff, you know. So that's mileage that's included there, too. And I think when you get 300 times around our roads, you know, that's one time. And, you know, it's a lot more than just driving around the roads, although there's some days that he's going around those roads twice after a storm. So, you know, I mean, it's...
Sean. You know, as Mr. Day mentioned, 25% increase. I agree with him. Maybe there should be a decrease on the whole budget itself by a certain percentage. And so then they allow the select board to spend the money where they need additional grading. But 25% is far too much of an increase. I'm sure you probably need some more for snow removal next year. And once the finish on the mileage, the federal standard is for mileage is 50, 55 cents or something like that. That means you would have to drive almost 5,000 miles down roads. So it's excessive in my world. Thank you.
I'm wondering about the sand. I'm looking at 51030. And once again, I don't know about roads, but I look at that gigantic sand pile that I drive by twice a day, every day, and I'm wondering, like, when is there enough sand? When do we have enough sand? It seems like we have enough sand for eternity out there at this point. Do we really just spend the same amount next year when we still have so much?
Well, I think, and Kevin backed me up, I think our sand pile is going to diminish quickly. And you'll see, you know, depending on what happens in March and April, we could run out of sand. Is that?
That's correct.
That sand pile looks big, but boy, go down there and look at how much is gone.
Let's see, Victoria and Jim, let's see some of that.
Just curious, because this isn't, I mean, we had some weeks of ice, but this wasn't a really bad winter event this year, and yet we went through more sand than I've seen in 12 years. So that just kind of makes me go, what's going on?
I think our contractors might have overdone on the flats, especially.
Jim?
Yeah, I was just going to try to clarify for Kate. There's a certain percentage, and it depends on how cold and how wet the sand is, that you can't use this year. Because it's frozen and they make these piles. That's what all those little piles are. And so you have to have a bigger pile of 1,000 yards. But traditionally, 800 to 1,000 yards is what we cover. Now, it is true that we used to just sand the hills. And then the flat, when it got to be like really icy, people got used to the sand. People got concerned about where driveway comes out, that should be sanded so that people can stop. You know, we hooked our anticipations of what we think a safe road is. And sometimes you have to sand so that you can park, you know, in anticipation. So it's not an easy call, it really isn't. But I would say that, you know, not buying too much sand because it doesn't dissolve, it doesn't go away. It's good for next year. Carries over.
The other thing I'd like to say too is when we buy our sand, we don't buy fine sand at all. We buy sand that when after the winter it acts almost as gravel. So it's 3/4 inch. I forget what the depth. So and that's another thing. Kevin goes out and he looks at the different sand pits to find out where we're going to get our sand from, because there's different options. You put down playground sand on our roads, it's worthless. It goes into the culverts. But if you use the heavier stuff, it kicks up on cars, but it also gives you better traction and acts as gravel.
I think Chris, she hasn't said anything yet. And then you guys.
Regarding the winter roads budget, I think we have seen a great year. Griffin got the contracts that seems to hit the numbers we had. I'm sure they were trying to do a good job. It seems like they must have worked well with the town because the results have been as good as they possibly can. Some sand on the flats can be a good thing too at times, for sure. But if, now that we've not accepted the other budget, would we be looking for another contract, 1-year contract with them, or possibly extend to a multi-year contract, especially to try to secure them if they're going to be able to maintain a within our budgets?
Our contractor does have a renewable in it, but and we reprice, so we wouldn't have to go out to bid. Now, if they come back, you know, we'll see what the rest of the winter comes with, you know, but I don't think we'll get it for $44,000 a year.
Mary and then Ken. Oh, did you still have a question?
Yeah.
Okay.
Just about the Sam and Griffin and Griffin, we're all pleased with the work that they've done. I live on, I guess, a flat, sort of, up on Puddle Dock. And I've at times thought, oh, more sand, you know, but we're not paying them anymore to do the work. They're just using a little more sand. And I think the end result has been great. So, I mean, the sand is part of the good job. It's that we've got these, you know, this great job in the winter.
Kevin?
Some years you get more ice than you do snow.
And that's the way it is.
So should we raise up the winter budget for them, anticipating that they won't be the 42 or 44 thousand? Instead of deficit spend?
I would rather keep it in there and see if we can come in to the total budget. I don't know what we're going to get from them, but if we put in a 20% increase, believe me, they're going to go to 25%. So if you got your budgeted item for next year that goes up a lot, that's the starting point.
Nancy was next, and then Eileen.
Is there a reason why you don't do a 3-year contract? You may be able to negotiate a lower bid if you secure them with a 3-year contract. I mean, they have to buy equipment to satisfy our needs.
We went out and bid 4 times, and this was the best we could get. So, you know, we were going to do a multi-year contract, and we couldn't get the papers. At least we have a clause in there that we can renegotiate for another year.
So,
yeah, I mean, thanks.
I'd like to call a question. I'd like to second that.
So there's a motion to call the questions and second it. All in favor of calling the questions, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay. We're going to vote.
So we're voting on the number, correct?
Correct. Because no one made a motion to amend.
So. I thought I had to fail, and then it was
a
no.
No, someone called the question,
I'd like to move that we do this with a show of hands.
Sounds good.
Normally we would, yes, either a show of hands or a aye. If you wanted a paper ballot, you would make that.
Oh, okay.
Sure.
Yes. I would just like to say welcoming Jim on board here, that looks like we've got a guy that's going to really scrutinize this as we go forward. So just like I said, if we're over budget, the taxpayers pay it next year. If we're under budget, that comes off the tax rate.
Okay, so we're all squared away. We're going to vote on Article 5, and it reads, shall the town of Granville vote to accept the budget of $398,264 to meet expenses and liabilities of the town and authorize the select board to set the tax rate sufficient to provide the same? A vote of aye or yes, the budget passes. They're asking for a raise of hands.
It was on the floor to do it by hand, and it was seconded.
Okay.
Order, I think you should do it by show of hands.
Okay. So, all in favor of Article 5, raise your hand. Yeah. All opposed?
22 to 9.
22 to 9. Okay. Article 5 passes as written. Motion to bring Article 6 to the floor.
So
second.
Shall the town of Granville vote to increase the highway capital investment account to the amount of $6,000 for the purpose of repaving town roads?
This is in there for, we put some money in the account in past years for the bottom of Aston Hill, Post Office Hill was paved. It's not paving new roads. So it's to repave the road. I think the estimate that we had to just pave Masson Hill was $24,000 or something a year ago. Kevin, I don't.
Post Office Hill, that estimate was, I believe, $16,000.
How much?
46 or 64, I can't remember.
All right, so paving is expensive. Paving is expensive.
Marilyn.
How much is in there now? $6,000.
We just started this last year, so there's
$6,000. Good. We have a. We're moving up.
It's already moved. Are they going to call it on the phone?
Right. We have a motion to call the question.
Seconded.
All in favor of calling the question, say aye.
Aye.
And opposed? Okay, so we're going to vote on Article 6. Shall the town of Granville vote to increase the highway capital investment account in the amount of $6,000 for the purpose of repaving town roads? All in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay.
I move Article 7.
Second.
Okay.
Christian, second.
Shall the town of Granville vote to increase the capital account for the purpose of covering expenses for fire protection in East Granville in the amount of $500?
So moved.
Second.
Question's been moved?
Second.
Seconded. All in favor of calling the question?
Aye.
Okay. All in favor of Article 7, say aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Opposed?
Huh?
You asked for opposed, yeah.
Oh, anybody opposed to Article 7? Sorry. Don't want to move Article 8.
Remove Article 8.
Thank you. Could be your own life if you weren't sitting.
Really? No.
Who wants to second it?
I'll second.
Article 8, shall the town of Granville elect two additional selectmen for a term of 2 years each as described in 17 VSA 2650B?
This was a petitioned article that was brought to the select board that we put on the warning. And I don't think it's necessary to have two more select people on the select board. I think over the years it's been difficult to find three committed people that are going to come to meetings and participate. I'm not totally averse. I think some people think that when they see Sean and I or Dick or I, you know, talking to each other, that there's collusion or something going on. Well, there's nothing true about that at all. We've never discussed anything, made any decision, contemplated any kind of business of the town without the public at a select board meeting. In a small town, you could obviously have people that have a beer together, walk a dog together, you know. So there's really no conspiracy or any kind of action that we take individually, you know. Because the open meeting law says that if two people go to a meeting, then it's got to be one. So if two of us go to a meeting, we're really supposed to have that warned that there's a select board meeting, okay? It's a difficult thing. If you have five people on, then two people can talk all day long and make up decisions and everything else to try to sell to the other people, and that's not against the law. But with a three-member board, it's difficult. You know, people see the garbage and they think, oh, they're deciding town business. It's not true. So I just want to make that clear. And Rochester had this on theirs, so they defeated it to go to five. This would take effect at the next town meeting. On the next special call meeting, so we'll have two more people if you decide to think about it.
What the people who submitted the petition, what is the advantage to see him doing this?
They can ask them, I don't know.
I don't know who.
Did anybody understand the question? Whoever.
The petitioners would like to speak, but I'd like to hear too.
So I'm the culprit. I wrote the petition article. So I just wrote down some quick pros and cons here. About the only con I can come up with is, well, now we have to find two more people to serve on the board. We sometimes have a hard time getting three. Just going off what you just said, Bruce, if there were a five-person board, that might alleviate some of the accusations that there are collusion. There is collusion going on because now there's five. Well, that almost impossible for that to happen.
Well, then two people can collude themselves and others.
Yeah. So pros, it's easier to have a quorum and attendance at meetings. If you have somebody or two people that call out, they're sick, they're on vacation, they have work, they can't attend, you still have the three there that can actually vote and make the meeting happen. You can delegate responsibilities amongst a much larger group.
People are willing.
If people are willing, absolutely. But I think, I mean, you guys put in a ton of time into the positions, and you don't get compensated for it, really. If we have more people there, you have a more broad representation of the sentiments of the community. It makes for an easier solution to situations where there might be a conflict of interest. in small towns, you know, we're friends with everybody, basically. We all know each other. We have some kind of connection. Well, if there's two members on the board currently who are friends with a contractor who's bid on work, well, they have to recuse themselves, really. Or it could be considered a conflict of interest. Well, now you have one person that can actually vote on it. That isn't going to work. Now, you would also have two positions that have shorter terms on them. In this case, I picked 2 years. You could have one. That might be more appealing to people who are looking to kind of get their feet wet, aren't really sure about local politics, and if they're going to like it, they might not be ready to commit for 3 years. And then last, institutional knowledge can be retained easier. What I mean by that is, if every year we would be electing two selectmen, you would still have three who are currently on the board who know what has transpired over the last 2 or 3 years. They've probably been through some training. They know what's going on. They can teach these two new people coming in. Where right now, you have a three-person board. If one resigns, one's due to be reelected, you have one that has to train these other two. Maybe they've only been there for a year. I don't know. So that's all I have.
Thank you. Any other comments on Article 8?
If we can't get the five people, what do? Just continue with whatever we have?
What do you mean, if you couldn't find two?
If we couldn't find them. I suppose the most we could do is four.
We would appoint the select board.
The select board, if there's a vacancy, a death, or somebody leaves town, then the remaining select board members appoint until the next annual meeting.
Sean?
So we're going to pay two more people to another $500, so it's another $1,000. Goes up and down. Well, each select person gets $500 a year. So now you're going to be paying another $1,000 for two more guys. And my question is, all the people I saw that signed on the list, how many of you guys are willing to be on the select board?
Select guys.
When I read the petition, it made sense to me. I think it's just easier to break a tie with more people, or not break a tie. You know what I mean. That was my.
Vivian and then G.
I just think it's easier to have more cronyism. If you have two extra people, how do you do that? I mean, how do you elect them? How does it work out for people get elected each year? People or what? How does it work? If you're desperate to find somebody to work together, all right, we really have that option being three people.
Gene?
Sean just pointed out one of the problems we have. We've got three guys up there. We would like to see more flexibility. And instead of saying select men, they select person. And that, it's just slipping the tongue, but it's
I apologize for that. I call girls guys too.
I'd like to just say that, you know, we have not had a meeting where we did not have a forum and had to cancel a meeting. So we've had the vast majority of our meeting, we've had three select board people out. There's been an occasion where we only have two, but we never had a lack of attendance.
You take Kate first, because she didn't talk in a while, then Marilyn.
Well, I just want to commend Daniel's well-thought-out consideration. I appreciate what he said. I really do. I think he presented it in a way I hadn't thought about it. That said, I think it's been very difficult over the years to get enough people to serve on all of our important boards. We had a hard time getting something to do with cemetery this year tonight. I just think it's unworkable to think that we would be able to have five people commit to this. And I agree with what Vivian said. I think that having people just going in for a year here and a year there, on the board, off the board, on the board, off the board, could end up being factions of people who are getting on just for a particular issue instead of having a longer view of a 3-year.
Meryl?
I agree with most of the points that have been made, and Daniel's argument in favor of it, but I do think that sometimes there's a whole part of the population that's unrepresented on the board. Just talking neighborhoods or sections of town or whatever, and like there are a lot of concerns over roads, and we have the fortune of living on Route 100, so we don't have to worry about the condition of the roads, although we're concerned for everyone else. But there's also all the folks that live in the valley, and there's, although you all represent all of us, there's no representation for the people who live on 100.
Vivian?
There's nothing preventing anyone from running for the board. No, nothing. Anyone can run for the board.
Can I move discussion ceasing call the question?
Judy's moving to call the question ceasing discussion.
I'll second.
Okay, Cheryl.
Paper ballot.
We have to.
Yeah, all in favor of ceasing. Say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? And we have a call for paper ballot. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Okay.
May.
So.
I'm reminded again, I'm pretty bad at this. Voting yes on Article 8 gives the town, we will be approving a 5-member select board to be in effect the latest next March, right?
The next town meeting.
A no means we keep it as is. Okay.
Thank you.
8. 15 yes, 24 no. So Article 8 does not pass.
Good.
Okay.
Article 9?
I second.
Okay, Article 9. Shall the town of Granville vote to authorize property taxes to be paid to the treasurer as provided by law in four?
So moved.
Okay, say goodbye or good night or whatever. All in favor of calling the question?
Aye.
Opposed? All in favor of Article 9 as written? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Article 9 passes.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear who made the motion.
Kate made the motion to call. Who seconded it?
I was just saying, Judy.
I think Judy.
Judy.
And then Christian called the question and I seconded it. And then we all said yay.
We moving Article 10?
Are we ready?
No,
Article
9.
Move Article 10.
I'll second that.
Okay, Article 10. Shall the town of Granville vote that overdue taxes will bear an interest rate of 1% per month or fraction thereof for the first 3 months and 1.5% after month for the fraction of the third dubious act?
I call the question.
Cheryl seconded it.
Kate called the question, Cheryl seconded it. All in favor of calling the question?
Aye.
Opposed? All in favor of Article 10?
Aye.
Opposed? Article 10 passes. Article 11.
I call Article 11.
The transaction and the other business to come for said meeting, and Judy has something to say.
I do. I just would like to make an urgent plea to interested people to join the Planning Commission. We will need to readopt our current plan by June of 2019. There are three of us working now. One of us is jumping ship.
That's me.
And really need some help.
Young people, this is a good opportunity to get involved.
Everything you've ever wanted to know about Granville.
Oh, thanks. It's really great.
March 21st, if you didn't notice the poster, March 21st is a Wednesday night. There's the rabies clinic at the Hancock Firehouse from 5 to 7.
Thank you.
And there's a poster up there on the wall there. So. Hopefully, if the town clerks are there, you might give a license.
March 27th?
21st.
Mark, send something to the